ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ओम गणानां त्वा गणपतिगुं हवामहे कविं कवीनां उपमश्रवस्तमम् श्री महागणाधिपतये नमः सदाशिवसमारंभां शंकराचार्यमध्यमां वंदे गुरुपरंपरां ओं सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ओं शांति शांति शांतिः अंधं तमः प्रविशन्ति ये विद्या मुपासते ततो भूय इवते तमो य उ विद्यायां रताः। अविद्या इज कर्म, विद्या इज उपासना। सो Ishvara has given the human being two faculties. So now we talk that language, not Sarvatma Bhava and all that. Now it is a Ishvara and human being. So the division is taken into account. Because karma and upasana presuppose division. Not in real terms, but a division subject to understanding the oneness. Anyway, so Ishvara has bestowed these two things upon human beings, namely the power of action, kriya shakti, and the power of knowing, vijnana shakti. And therefore, we have to have a proper balance. Samuchaya means proper balance. Where a proper balance is possible and needed, there we should have it. Where you cannot club the two, there you should keep them separate. So, for mixing water and milk, there must be a proper proportion. For any effort to mix oil and water is wrong, because they cannot be mixed. So, that is how samuchaya and samanvaya have to be understood. Anyway, karma and upasana have to be appropriately pursued in one's life. So in worshipping Ishvara, we have to use karma as well as upasana. So both must be there. See, this is what is called andha pangunyaya. Our life itself is like that. It is lived by the andha pangunyaya. Andha is a blind person. Pangu is a lame person who cannot walk, who has a problem in legs. So now what happens is, so these two people, severally, they were going to Badrinath. So on the road to Badrinath, the andha is strong and he can walk, no problem, but he cannot see. Pangu is, he nicely sees, but he cannot walk. So they met on the way and so they made a team. Now the team is, the andha will lift the pangu and puts him on his shoulders, because he is strong. And so the andha will show the way and the pangu will walk the way. So a nice combination, andha pangu nyaya. So hands and legs, etc., the organs of action are the andha, and the eyes, ears, etc., the sense organs are pangu. So we combine them, karmendriyas and jnanendriyas, and live a life. It is a nice samuchaya. It's not that I will use only karmendriyas in the morning and only jnanendriyas in the evening. It's not like that. They are used in tandem all the time. So the same thing applies to our life of spirituality also, that we follow karma and upasana in appropriate proportions in the life. We live a life in which both find nice place. That is samuchaya. Anyway, we were looking at the bhashya. So the samuchaya has to be praised. To praise the method of praising the samuchaya is censuring karma and upasana pursued exclusively. So if somebody pursues karma exclusively, you throw some ninda upon that person. Andhantam of pravishanti. Then there is another person. This is how human mind works. If there is a possibility of committing a mistake, then the mistake is committed. There is a law. Again, Peters Murphy says one such a law is there. If a thing can go wrong, it will certainly go wrong. That is how the human mind works. In fact, if there is a possibility of committing two mistakes, then there will be two people committing the two mistakes. And then there will be followers also. If these people are leaders, then they will have followers. And they will have a sect going. And a huge superstructure will be built around this mistake. And once that kind of a structure is built, now it is very difficult to handle it, because it derives its strength from the numbers, from the structures, and from the economics. So it becomes like that. Very difficult. Therefore, this mistake should not be done. We should have an appropriate mix of both karma and upasana. Pursuing one exclusively to the exclusion of the other is wrong. So that way a ninda is mentioned, just to praise the importance of having a proper combination of the two. So we were looking at the bhashya. Tataha tasmat andhatmaka tamasaha bhuyaha iva bahutarameva. So that iva means eva, te tamah pravishanti. So here the upasakasa tamaha, what is the ignorance of the darkness of the darkness in the context of an upasaka. So exclusive upasakas. They don't do any karma, only upasana they will be doing. So we come across such people, many of them. So for them the darkness, tamaha, is aham mama abhimana rupam. That is, I was describing that also. So they think two ways. One, my upasana is superior to other people's upasana, and also jnanam, and also to karma. So the person is doing one upasana, he thinks that he is superior to all karmis, and he is superior to all jnanis, all yoga people. He is superior to every other pursuit. His pursuit is superior to every other pursuit. This is mama abhimana. And then aham abhimana. Among the same kind of upasakas, I am the supreme. So this is aham abhimana. These two abhimanas, they will overwhelm this upasaka, and therefore he is now in the darkness, very dense darkness. The abhimana, it is like that. The ahankara is the densest darkness that is possible. And once a person is trapped in it, very difficult to come out of it. Anyway, bhashyakara, ke karma hitva ye u ye tu vidyayameva देवता ज्ञाने एवा रताः अभिरताः. Who are these people who enter प्रविशन्ति into even more blinding darkness? Who are they? के सो ए क्वेश्चन. दिस इज व्हाट इज भाष्य. भाषा भाषा भाष्य. व्हाट इज सेड इन भाषा इज कॉल्ड भाष्य. भाषा मीन्स बोली. सो स्पोकन वर्ड्स. Who are they? K. Question. He puts the question, he answers the question. U means tu, on the other hand. Ye, whosoever. Vidyayam evarataha means karma hitva. They won't do karma. These upasakas, they won't do karma. So he will be doing upasana up to midnight, or even after midnight. 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock upasana. And then he will have phalaharam. నైవేద్యం, ఆల్ కైండ్స్ ఆఫ్ సిల్లీ ఫలహారా హీ విల్ హ్యావ్. ఈజ్ ఉపాసక, నోబడీ కెన్ క్వశ్చన్ హిమ్. దెన్ హీ గోస్ టు స్లీప్ అండ్ మార్నింగ్ సన్ ఈజ్ రైజింగ్, హీఈ్ స్లీప్. సో హీ సపోజ్ టు డూ అర్ఘ్య ప్రధానం అండ్ ఆల్ దట్ మార్నింగ్ ప్రేయర్స్ హీ సపోజ్ టు డూ, ఈ వోంట్ డూ దాట్. సో కర్మహిత్వా, జస్ట్ ఐఎమ్ ట్రయింగ్, ఐఎమ్ క్రియేటింగ్ ఎ సిచ్యువేషన్ వేర్ ది స్టేట్మెంట్ కర్మహిత్వా బికమ్స్ రిలెవెంట్. చోడ్కర్, కర్మ చోడ్కర్, హ్యావింగ్ లెఫ్ట్ ది కర్మ ఎలోన్, హీఈ్ నాట్ సపోజ్ టు డూ దట్, యు నో. సో హీ థింగ్స్ దట్ హీఈ్ డూయింగ్ ఉపాసన, దేర్ ఫార్ దిస్ కర్మ ఎట్సెట్రా ఈజ్ ఫర్ ఇన్ఫీరియర్ పీపుల్, నాట్ ఫర్ హిమ్. సో ఫర్ హిమ్ ఓన్లీ విద్య. విద్య మీన్స్ దేవతా జ్ఞానం. జ్ఞానం ఈజ్ ఉపాసన. జ్ఞానం ఈజ్ నాట్ సచ్చిదానంద అండ్ ఆల్ దట్. జ్ఞానం ఈజ్ ఉపాసన, కాంటెక్స్ట్. సో దేవతా జ్ఞానం మీన్స్ దేవతో ఉపాసన. ఇన్ వేద ది వర్డ్స్ ఆర్ యూస్డ్ లైక్ దట్. సో విద్య అండ్ విద్య మీన్స్ ఉపాసన యాజ్ వెల్ యాజ్ ఆత్మ విద్య. సో ఏవం వేద, యూ హియర్ ఇట్ ఆల్ ది టైమ్, ఏవం వేద, దట్ వేర్ వేద ఈజ్ ఉపాసతే ఇచ్చర్థ. ఆల్ ఉపాసన. ఆయతనవాన్ భవతి, ఉపాసన అండ్ ఫలం, ఉపాసన అండ్ ఫలం, దట్ ఈజ్ ఆల్ ఉపాసన. వేద మీన్స్. సో బ్రహ్మ విత్, విత్ ఈజ్ వేద ఓన్లీ, దట్ ఈజ్ జ్ఞానం, నాట్ ఉపాసన. సో కాంటెక్స్ట్. విద్యాయామేవ దేవతా జ్ఞానే ఏవ రతా. యుసి దేవతా జ్ఞాన, షల్ ఐ టెల్ యూ హౌ? యుసి దేవతాస్ ఆర్ ప్లూరల్. హీ జస్ట్ డజంట్ కన్సిడర్ ఎనీథింగ్ బియాండ్ దట్ స్ట్రక్చర్. దేవతాస్ ఆర్ ప్లూరల్. నో, వాట్ ఈస్ దేవత? దిస్ ప్లూరాలిటీ దట్ వీ ఆర్ హ్యాండ్లింగ్, సో వాట్ ఈస్ ఇట్స్ రియాలిటీ అండ్ వాట్ ఈస్ ది డీపర్ మీనింగ్? ఆల్ దీస్ థింగ్స్ ఆర్ జస్ట్ నథింగ్ ఫర్ హిమ్, ఓన్లీ దేవతాస్. అండ్ దెన్ దేవతా సర్క్లోరల్. అండ్ ఈచ్ దేవత విల్ గివ్ మీ సంథింగ్. ఆల్రెడీ హీ ఫిక్స్డ్, దిస్ దేవత విల్ గివ్ వెల్త్ టు మీ, దట్ దేవత విల్ గివ్ హెల్త్ టు మీ, అండ్ దిస్ దేవత విల్ గివ్ సంథింగ్ ఎల్స్. పుత్ర, వన్ పర్టికులర్ దేవత ఈజ్ రిజర్వ్డ్ ఫర్ గివింగ్ పుత్ర, అండ్ అనదర్ పర్టికులర్ దేవత ఫర్ గివింగ్ పౌత్ర. సో లైక్ దిస్ ఆల్ ప్లూరల్ ప్లూరల్ ప్లూరల్, జంపింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ వన్ దేవత టు అదర్. ఓకే, నైస్, ఫెయిర్ ఎనఫ్. ఆల్ ఉపాసనాస్ ఆర్ దేర్. బట్ దెన్ సో ఏకం సద్విప్రా బహుధా వదంతి. నో నో ఏకం బిజినెస్. సో వెరీ ఇంట్రెస్టింగ్. దిస్ ఈజ్ యు సీ, వన్స్ ఐ వెంట్ టు ఎ టెంపుల్. దిస్ ఈజ్ దేవతా జ్ఞానం. జస్ట్ ఐఎమ్ ట్రయింగ్ టు కన్స్ట్రక్ట్ ఏ పిక్చర్ ఫర్ ది వర్డ్ హియర్ బికాస్ దిస్ ఈజ్ మై హ్యాబిట్. సమ్టైమ్స్ దిస్ హ్యాబిట్ పేస్ వెల్, and pace means it is useful. Sometimes it could be a problem also. The habit is to apply what is here to the life, that is the habit. Anyway, so I went to a temple unexpectedly. Inside there are a dozen shrines are there, and then half a dozen purohits are busy conducting half a dozen different kinds of pujas. And so here one puja is going on. This is a Gauri puja. And then go a little further, there Chandi puja is going on. Then you go a little further, there Ganesh puja is going on. Then you go a little further, Navagraha puja is going on. With particular graham again. With Navagraha they don't want. They want only one graha among those Nava. Generally, because all the Nava are in one place, so they are sitting there and doing Navagraha puja. Then you go a little further, Ayyappa puja is going on. And all are, it is as though they won't say it, but is almost making a statement that these are all different devatas, worshipped by different people, for different reasons and for different reasons. This is called devatajnana. So, it is relevant in a particular place and time. But that alone is everything. Devata jnane eva rataha, abhirataha, abhimukhyena rataha. They are attached to the plurality, to the names, forms, to the worship, the mode, the mantra, the particular kind of upasana and the results thereof. All fixed. And I am attached to this now. This is how it is. This is the devata jnanam. and then karma sandhyavandanam. Nobody performs sandhyavandana. Sandhyavandana is the daily prayer, morning meditation prayer. They don't pay any attention to that. That is, either it is paid least attention or no attention at all. Once it was, I got up at 5, 4:30, took to bath, Maghasnanam, Sunday, took to bath and started doing japa. So the Guruji, in the Gurukulam, he was noticing it's all wonderful. He also took to bath and all that. Well, very good, the boy is doing a good thing. And then I am doing japam and japam and japam. Then it is sun is rising. He asked me, what japam you are doing? Yeah, mantra japa, that particular mantra. Did you do sandhyavandana? No. Why? Because I took a vow to do this japam this much today. No, not at the cost of nitya karma. Sandhyavandanam you do, at the time of sandhyavandanam. And finish sandhyavandana and do japam. This is one lesson which I learned. Then another time. Next day is the exam. Some exam. And that evening, I was doing japa. The guru saw. The teacher who is in charge of the gurukulam, he saw. He thought that he will do japa for 5-10 minutes, etc. And I will come back and study. So, but then I am not coming back. I am doing japa and japa and japa. Then he waited for 30 minutes and then came. And he told me one point. You see, there is a proverb, chaduvu sandhya. Chaduvu means study. Sandhya means worship. Saduvu sandhya, that is the sequence. Study, and that is the sequence. Not sandhya chaduvu. He asked me, did you hear chaduvu sandhya, study worship, or worship study? Which is the thing which you hear all the time? I told him, yeah, it is always chaduvu sandhya. Then what are you doing? Did you study for tomorrow? Almost. Then you go and finish that almost also. Enough of japam today. When the exams will be over in another 3 days, then you start doing japam. In the summer, you put a target and do japam. So this is another lesson. So this way, devata jnana should not overwhelm us. So much so, we are not doing our karma, nitya karma we are not doing. And so this is very important. Devata jnanam is good, but that should not become the cause of avoiding nitya karma. So there must be a proper proportion. The verse is over, but before going to the next verse, you see, sometimes the avidya and vidya, In a little stretched way, they can mean sangraha and bhoga. Sangraha means acquiring resources. Bhoga means spending the resources and enjoying a few things. I'm not talking of sense pleasures and all that. So suppose you make money. You have to spend it. And while spending it, you have to spend it purposefully. So that is called bhoga. So there must be a balance between the two, sangraha and bhoga. There is a person called bhogi, and there is another person called sangrahi. Sangrahi is also called lobhi. So this person goes on acquiring and acquiring and acquiring. Suppose he gets salary, say 1,000 units or dollars. Then he saves some 500 or 600 out of it, he saves. And you see, one day, one gentleman, the wife asked, let us purchase a TV. A TV we can see occasionally. You go to office, I can see TV, and the kids also will enjoy it. And I am alone at home, I want to have a TV. Then this man told, TV costs $600. And if we invest this $600 in a fixed deposit, we will get very good rent. Whereas this versus the dialogue is, this TV is a dead investment. That is what he said. Dead investment. It is like the paint put onto the wall. You won't get it back. You don't get anything out of it. So like this, you purchase the TV, and now all that money is invested and dead investment because it will be no return. You cannot even take the original, leave alone return. So it is gone. That is what he told. Then she told, from today onwards you take food only one time. Because by not taking food a second time, you will not be wasting resources and you can invest that money also in the bank. That is what she told. So it should not be like that, you know. Then he told, okay, we will purchase the TV. Therefore, there must be sangraha. You have to invest, suppose 1,000 units, 1,000 rupees you are getting. Okay, use some 700, 800, and 100 or 150 you save for the future. Everything you save, go on saving and saving and saving. We come across such people, only saving, every time saving only, no expenditure. And then there are other people, spend. What all in the pocket, you spend. And then put a signature, get a credit card, and now spend on it. And then this credit card, nobody is giving any credit, then somebody will offer, you want a credit card? Yes, I want. Give it, take it. Pay $10 down payment, take a credit card, and spend another 1,000 on it. So goes on spending, and then whosoever gives loan, take it and spend. Now he has credit card problems. So he has spent so much excess over his income. So this is bhogi. Both are bad. You should have a balance between the two. You should have sangraha and you should have bhoga. So use the money judiciously, spend it and save something and spend something. So there must be a judicious mix. You should not do one thing to the exclusion of the other. So you have to have a samuchaya. You can look at that verse that way. Next. Anyadevahurvidyaya Anyadahuravidyaya Itishushrumadhiranam Yenastadvichachakshire. Here we have a little avatarika. It could be a little technical. We will go through two sentences of the technical discussion and then understand the verse. Tatra avantara phalabhedam vidyakarmanoh samuchaya karanamaha anyatha phalavada phalavatoh अंगांगित सन्निहितयोः अंगांगितया जामितैव स्यात् इति. यू सी, बिफोर स्टडीइंग वेदांत दे टीच सम मीमांसा टेक्स्ट दे टीच, बिकॉज व्हेन यू स्टडी वेदांत उपनिषद्स, सो देर इज अ वे ऑफ मेकिंग प्रोग्रेस. इट्स नॉट दैट स्टडी वन ऑर टू उपनिषद्स and then conclude, the study of Vedanta is over now. It should not be like that, you know. The person should study all the major Upanishads, 10 of them. And then just read translations and finish it. That is not... You see, when you say for the entire life you are devoting to the study of Vedanta, then there is no reason to be superficial like that. So... it is not that a person is attending 1 week course for the entire year, therefore he has to study some superficial things and move on, I can understand. But if he is to devote his entire life to study of Vedanta, then this is a paradox or even a contradiction that the person should have very good knowledge of Sanskrit. There is no reason why he should not have it. Now he should study all Sanskrit and grammar and kavyas, and he should be a scholar of Sanskrit, number one. Number two, he must study all the Upanishads with bhashyas, etc. And there is no reason why he should not study. He can study some 12 to 15 hours a day. Who stops him? And he can study like that for a decade minimum. That should be the approach. So this is a bit traditional thing. So, what they do in the traditional method, they teach some Mimamsa first, because you go to Upanishads. Upanishad is what? 40th chapter. So, you want to study 40th chapter, There are 39 chapters earlier. It is all one ekavakyata. The Shruti is a driving thing after thing in a particular sequence. And so you want to land, coming from the sky, I land at the 40th. Nothing to do with the 39. When you do that, then sometimes you may have to make a mention of what is gone by. And the moment you make a mention of it, it is difficult to understand. It should not be like that. So, some basic rules of Mimamsa, Purva Mimamsa, have to be studied and understood. So that the same rules will be applied in Vedantic discourse also, because Vedanta is the culmination of karma and upasana. Karma, upasana, jnanam. That is the culmination. And so, while going into the jnanam directly, some idea of karma upasana must be there. So, they teach Mimamsa. In fact, not a lot of Mimamsa. Some Mimamsa. Like for example, there is a text called Artha Sangraha. The text they teach. So, now you study that. It takes a month or month and a half. Nothing more than that. I was teaching it somewhere Muprakashi or somewhere when I was there for a long time. A few sadhus wanted to study some Mimamsa, somebody advised them, study some Mimamsa, I say. So they came to me and I taught that Artha Sangraha text. So what I mean is, by learning a few things of Mimamsa, the understanding will improve. Anyway, so you pay some attention. You are now learning a little Mimamsa. Here, Vidya and Karma, they are there. Vidya is Upasana, Karma is Karma, Nitya Karma. So, the worship, which is in the form of karma, and the mental worship is vidya. This is what we are talking about, not atmajnanam. So, atmajnanam discussion is over. We may talk of it later, but not anywhere here. So, what is the reason for doing samuchaya of the two? Here we are planning to do samuchaya. The first step of samuchaya we have done. What is that? Censuring each when pursued exclusively. So what does it show to you? Each when pursued exclusively is not good. Each is good. Karma is good. Upasana is good. Pursued exclusively is not good. What does it mean? How the direction of the statement, what do you see from that? Don't you see that it is directing towards samuchaya? That is how the language is. That is one samuchaya. Then there is another point here. You see, there are two things. One is the primary and the other secondary to that primary, auxiliary to that primary. In such a situation, you don't need a samuchaya specially, because it is already samuchaya. Suppose I ask you are doing Satyanarayana Puja. Then you do Pushpa Puja, 108 names, and then do Naivedyam, Adhupa Deepa Naivedya. Now, do you need to mandate samuchaya for dhopa deepa and naivedya? Not necessary. Because they are both part of one karma, one thing. And therefore, so dhopa deepa is the anga, auxiliary to what is called vratam. Naivedyam is another anga to the vratam. Therefore, they will be performed automatically. Vratam is what? Suppose you say puja or vratam. What is it? As such, there is no vratam other than its content. Vratam is nothing other than its content. And the content is step 1, step 2, step 3, like that, 16 steps. And all these steps, when they are performed in a sequence, in a proper sequence, now you have made the vratam. Now vratam is in place. As such, other than the 16 steps, there is no vratam. Vratam is these 16 steps only. And therefore, when you talk of the vrata, these 16 steps are auxiliary, anga. You stay with the word anga. If these steps are anga, then vratam is what? Angi. This is called angangi bhava. So, in the case of anga and angi, is there any need to mandate samuchaya? This angi should have all the angas. That kind of a mandate, is it needed? Not needed. Because unless the angas are in place, there is no angi at all. Angi is nothing more than the combination of all the angas. Therefore, when you say this is angi, that is anga, these are angas, already samuchaya is involved in it. It is inbuilt in it. You need not mandate samuchaya separately. You understood that point? Then, how to decide if there are two things, one is angi and another is anga, how to decide? Vakya mimamsa, you know. So, how to decide which is angi and which is anga? I tell you how. There is a law, the mimamsak nyaya. Phalavat sannidhau aphalam tadangam. That is the rule. Phalavat sannidhau aphalam tadangam. The meaning of that vakya is like this. This is Jaimini's nyaya. So, the meaning is like this. It says, suppose the vakya is there like that. By doing Satyanarayana vratam or any vrata, you get punyam. This vakya is there. This is the karma. And what kind of karma? Phalavat. Phala is also mentioned, you know. Punyam is the phalam. So that is one thing, karma. Okay, agreed. Then below that, there is another vakya. The vakya is, in this vrata, naivedyam must be a sweet preparation. That is the vakya. No phalam. By doing naivedya of a sweet preparation, you get punyam. It is not that kind of vakya. Aphalam. There is no phala. It is said like this, by doing this vrata, you get punyam. And the naivedyam is a sweet preparation. Two vakyas. The first vakya is phalavat. The second vakya is aphalam. That is one thing. And also, the second vakya is in the context of the first vakya, sannidhau. It is in the, just following that, in its proximity. Therefore, from this situation, what do we conclude? We conclude that this second vakya, which is aphala, and which is in the sannidhi of the first being the phalavat, the second vakya becomes an anga, auxiliary to the first. You followed that? Okay. So, 2 points you have understood. Suppose a third point I will ask you a question. There is one vakya, which is phalavat. Then another vakya, which is also phalavat. Now, are they independent? Or one of them anga to the other? What answer you will tell? Independent. They are independent. Right? They are independent. So, this is the discussion. Phalavad aphalavato sannihitayoho angangitaya. Now, here karma is there. Vidya is there. Now, vakya is there. Karmana pitrulokaha. By doing karma, you will gain pitruloka, a heaven. Vidyaya devalokaha. By the upasana, you gain devaloka, another level of heaven. Now, this karma and vidya, I ask you a question, you reply. This karma and vidya, are they independent? Or are they anga, angi? They are independent. Because each is having phala. Therefore, if karma is given phalam and vidya is not mentioned, any phala is not mentioned for vidya, then vidya could become auxiliary to karma. There are many such vidyas. They are called karmanga upasanas. The upasana itself has no phalam. It becomes a part of the karma, and the karma, overall karma has phalam. Karmanga upasanas. Then there are upasanas with a particular phalam, and a small karma is part of that. So upasana could be the angi and karma the angam. But here the situation is not like that. Here karma is independent because it is phala. But how the independence is established? Phala. Phala establishes the independence. Karma is phalavat, karmana pitrulokaha. Therefore it is independent. Independent of vidya, upasana. Because vidya ఈజ్ హ్యావింగ్ ఇట్స్ ఓన్ ఫలం. విద్యయ దేవలోక. సో కర్మ ఈజ్ ఇండిపెండెంట్, విద్య ఈజ్ ఇండిపెండెంట్. దేర్ ఫార్ వన్ మే గెట్ ది నోషన్ దట్ హీ మే పెర్ఫార్మ్ కర్మ ఎక్స్క్లూజివ్లీ వితౌట్ బాదరింగ్ అబౌట్ విద్య, బికాస్ దే ఆర్ ఇండిపెండెంట్. దే ఆర్ మ్యాండేటెడ్ ఇండిపెండెంట్లీ, హ్యావింగ్ ఇట్స్ ఓన్ ఫలం, ఈచ్ హ్యావింగ్ ఇట్స్ ఓన్ ఫలం. దేర్ ఫార్ ఇఫ్ సంబడి ఈజ్ పెర్ఫార్మింగ్ కర్మ ఎక్స్క్లూజివ్లీ, హీఈస్ ఓకే ఫర్ వాట్ హీఈస్ డూయింగ్. అండ్ ఇఫ్ సంబడి ఎల్స్ ఈజ్ పెర్ఫార్మింగ్ ఉపాసన, ఈజ్ ఆల్ రైట్ ఇన్ హిస్ ప్లేస్, బట్ ది సముచ్చయ విల్ బి మోర్ అప్రోప్రియేట్. ద శృతి హ్యావింగ్ ఇండిపెండెంట్లీ మ్యాండేటెడ్ కర్మ అండ్ ఉపాసన, నౌ ఇట్ ఈస్ మ్యాండేటింగ్ సముచ్చయ. సపోజ్ ఉపాసన ఇస్ దేర్, కర్మ వర్ టు బి ఇట్ సంగ, వర్ ఐఎమ్ సేయింగ్ ఇట్ యు జస్ట్ యు అస్యూమ్, ఇఫ్ ఇట్ ఈస్ టు బి అస్యూమ్డ్ దట్ కర్మ ఈజ్ అంగా ఫర్ ఉపాసన, దెన్ ఆల్రెడీ అంగాంగి భావ ఈజ్ ఎస్టాబ్లిష్డ్. ఇన్ సచ్ సిచ్యువేషన్ ఇఫ్ సముచ్చయ ఈజ్ అగైన్ మ్యాండేటెడ్ ఇట్ విల్ బీ ఏ పునరుక్తి, రైట్? సో దట్ ఈజ్ ఆల్ హీ సేస్. అన్యథ ఇసి తత్ర అవాంతర ఫలభేదం విద్యాకర్మణో సముచ్చయ కారణం ఆహా. సో అవాంతర ఫలభేద విద్యాకర్మణో, విద్యాఫలం ఇస్ డిఫరెంట్, కర్మఫలం ఇస్ డిఫరెంట్. సో దే ఆర్ టూ ఇండిపెండెంట్ ఎఫర్ట్స్ అండ్ దేర్ ఫార్ ఇట్ ఈస్ పాసిబుల్ టు బి పర్స్యూడ్ ఎక్స్క్లూజివ్లీ. దేర్ ఫార్ శృతి వాంట్స్ అస్ టు పర్స్యూ దెమ్ టుగెదర్. దేర్ ఫార్ సముచ్చయ ఈస్ కమింగ్ నౌ. అన్యథ సపోజ్ దే ఆర్ నాట్ టూ ఇండిపెండెంట్ థింగ్స్, దెన్ వాట్ హ్యాపెన్స్? వన్ ఆఫ్ దెమ్ మస్ట్ బి ప్రైమరీ అండ్ ది అదర్ సెకండరీ, ఆక్సిలియరీ. The primary is phalavat, the auxiliary is aphalavat. In such a situation, one is the auxiliary to the other primary, and then sannihitayoh, sannidhi is also there. That is the nyaya which I told, phala phala sannidhau, phalavat sannidhau, aphalam tadangam. So sannidhi is there, one of them is phalavat, the other is aphala, no phalam. Sannidhi is there, therefore one becomes auxiliary to the other. And then they are always pursued together only. So, in which case, angangi bhava is already established. Angangitaya jamitaivasyat. If you now talk of samuchaya, that samuchaya becomes punarukti, a dosham. Therefore, that dosha you cannot accept. It is not there, that dosha is not there for shruti. Okay, so what is the conclusion? Now samuchaya is being mandated for karma and upasana, which are independent pursuits. That is how the samuchaya is coming into the picture. Anyway, I am done with that discussion. Let us move to the mantra. Anyadeva ahuhu vidyaya. So there is upasana. By this upasana, what you get is indeed different. So now phala phala. This has its own phalam, that has its own phalam. Two independent things. So, very pakka procedure. First, each is censured exclusively. Then, each is talked of having phala independently. Now, the ground is ready for samuchaya. Anyadahuhu avidyaya. Suppose you do devata upasana only, vidya. Then you will get phala. Some different phala, something. Some phala, whatever that phala is. Then if you perform karma, then it will have phala too. Anyadahura vidyaya. So each is independent. Like that we were hearing. It is shruma. We heard shruti, you know. Shruti means the mantra doesn't say, this is what we have read in a book. Like that it won't say. It only says shruma. Because Vedanta is listened to. I went to a Mahatma. In Nelakanthi, some name. So there were a few brahmacharis with me. They introduced me to him. In fact, I told no introduction. I will go and touch his feet and we will move on. So spend some time and move on. But they are enthusiastic. They introduced. They were studying some texts with me. So they introduced. Brahmacharis and sadhus also. our Swami. So he teaches Brahma Sutra, etc. Then that Mahatma asked me. He asked in Sanskrit, so Sanskrit or Hindi? So aap to Vedanta padhe hai? Like that he asked me. Did you study Vedanta? In fact, he asked me a second time. Ab to Vedanta padhe hai, padha hai, like that. I got the trick. First time I did not notice. I wanted to say, yes, I studied Vedanta a little. Like that I was about to say. Then when he repeated the question, even before my answering, with a lot of emphasis on that word padha hai, then I noticed it. I told Mahatma ji, मैं तो वेदांत का श्रवण किया था. That is what he told. Then he told me, yes, you are right. Then he told me, वेदांत श्रवण किया जाता है, पढ़ा नहीं जाता. That is what he told. So वेदांत is listened to. श्रवणम, it is just some English translation. You have to translate it, word to word translation. And therefore, to that extent it is correct. श्रूयते. So Vedanta is listened to. But the meaning of the word Shravanam is not just listening. You see, it is Shabda Pramana, you know. Shravanam means Shabda Pramana. Suppose you just listen, it comes under Pratyaksha. How it is Shabda? Listening is Pratyaksha, you know. Aksha it is. It is a sense organ, like seeing, listening. This is Pratyaksha. So how Shabda Pramana? Therefore, listening is not, Shravanam is Shabda Pramana. Therefore, it is not listening with the ears. It is not the sounds that you listen. Sounds that you listen is not Shabda Pramana. It is only Pratyaksha Pramana. So, then what is this Shravanam? Tatparya Nishchayanukulo Vyaparaha. Of course, you listen through the ears. And the mind recognizes the words. The mind has a mechanism by which it recognizes the words. So there is a lot of discussion on that mechanism. For example, I say Ramaha. The knowledge happens to the person who hears it. How did it happen? When did it happen? How did it happen? This is the analysis. So when I said Ra, did it happen? No, it cannot. Suppose I say Ra, does that knowledge happen? No. Did it happen when I said Ma? No. Did it happen when I said aha? If you say yes, there is a danger in it. Because next time I will say aha. Now knowledge happened to you? Therefore, so it is not that simple as it looks. So they describe it like this. The knowledge happens in a jiffy, in a moment it happens. But there is a progress. Or there is a leading to that moment. So first Ra is heard, then a gap must be there. If I pronounce without gap, then knowledge won't happen. Because only when there is a gap, you should distinguish the gap. Then only you will distinguish the word, syllable Ra and Ma separately. If you don't distinguish the gap there, then knowledge won't happen. Therefore, it is like bytes. When you type, there is a byte for a syllable and there is a, you know, computer byte. There is a byte for space also. Space is also byte. You should not think that space is not counted in bytes. So in so many kilobytes, the document is so many kilobytes. So that kilobytes will have syllables, also spaces. And the change of paragraph is also a few bytes it consumes. So like that. Therefore, mind recognizes sounds and also the gaps in between. And connects them. Suppose I say Maraha, then that knowledge won't happen. The sequence must be there. So mind recognizes syllables, gaps, and the sequences. All it recognizes. And the recognition happens. And when the last syllable is recognized, knowledge happens. Therefore, knowledge, it happens in a moment, but there is a process leading up to that moment. This is how knowledge happens. Knowledge of the sound. Therefore, listening is not just the ears have picked up the sound. That is not just listening. It is not even that the words are recognized by the mind. So even when you don't know the meaning, you recognize the word. Suppose I say some Sanskrit word which you don't know, like spashaha. You may not know its meaning, but still you heard the word you recognized. And then you will ask, Swamiji, you just now said spashaha, what does it mean? So you have heard the word, the mind has recognized everything, but that is not shravanam. You should know the meaning. Then I say spashaha means a spy. Now you have known. Therefore, so in Vedanta even that is not a shravanam. Prachaksha, then this recognizing the sound as a word with a meaning, they have a name for it. It is in Vyakarana, they call it spota. Spotavada, etc. is there. So the meaning is recognized. But that is not a shravanam. That is happening every day. When you talk with the other person, you are doing shravanam only. What he is saying, you are doing shravanam. That is not the shravanam which we are talking here. So it is not enough to recognize the meaning. Because when you see the flower, I am the seer and the flower is the seen. There is a division. The duality is there. Similarly, when I hear this sound, same thing happens. When I hear this sound, I am the one who hears, and the sound is the thing that is heard. Therefore, hearer, heard. The division is there. Therefore, that is not shravanam. We listened to Vedanta class. That is not shravanam. You listened to Vedanta class by keeping this division, or it is just there is no division. There is no listener, listened to division. There is only listening. Like, you pour water on sponge. You pour water on the floor, on the marble floor. The water that is poured on the marble floor remains there. Marble also remains. Each remains in its place. The water you pour on the sponge. Now you don't see the water. Only sponge is there. So, sometime I will discuss this shravanam in a little more detailed way. So, shravanam is, you listened to something, not as a person listening to something. If that is the case, then the division just persisted, and that is not shravanam. So, by the time you listened to something, the person is not there, the listened to is not there, only the knowingness is there. The knowledge is there. That is a shravanam. Tatpariyam. Spuranam is used in a slightly different sense also. Yes, spota is different from spuranam. Spuranam is shining. Shining is a spuranam. Therefore, yeah, you can say that. So now you know it. Without the knower being there, there is only knowledge. There is only knowledge. It happens. Suppose you ask a doubt, some Panini Sutra, etc., you ask a doubt. The doubt is there for months, or for weeks, or for days, and then you don't have an opportunity to clarify it. Now you find a person and ask him. He will tell it he knows it, he doesn't take much. You just waited for 1 week, but he may take only 30 seconds to explain it. It is said. Then you know it. Yeah, I know it. It is a kind of aha effect, as my friend says. So then you know it. At the moment of knowing, there is no division. There is only knowing. No knower, known division. You know it. Yeah, I know it. That is a shravana. That's why when that shravanam doesn't happen, so what is all that is said and heard, it remains at the point of verbal statement only. It is just verbal. So the lips articulate and the ear picks up the sound. So it goes on and on and on. That is not shravanam. So tatparya nishchayanukulo vyaparaha. Now I know it. That is shravanam. That's why shravanam is difficult in the sense that The person must be totally open-minded. Any element of self-image in the context of the Shravanam, so any particular element of self-image or judgment of the other person, or self-judgment or the judgment of the other person, it stands like a wall. And already we know something, some values, some ideas, some concepts we already have. Then that also stands like a, it all, what happens is, yeah, what is being taught is already known to me. So I am listening to something which is known to me already. So that kind of a division already created. Here I am, was known, and this is which is already known, to be known or already known. So it comes under the category of already known. So then already you have created division. Even before listening to the first word, you have created division. And so the division persists. Even without any such thing, division persists. Mind is inclined to divide. If in addition to that original tendency, if you have all the more reason to keep it divided, then the division alone persists. And so knowledge won't happen. That's why knowledge means the understanding itself won't happen. The insight itself doesn't develop. So once you do Shravanam, and yes, I know, that way it happens, if it happens, then that means Shravanam has happened. And then the next moment, or after a while, half a dozen doubts will arise from that Shravanam. A number of doubts will come. Two people attended my class, freshly. Immediately, they are walking. One of them is asking the other person, just wait, I have to have a word with Swamiji. That person is told, you said we have to attend the class, we have attended, let us move on, bus will go away. That person is dragging him out, and this person is dragging him in. Anyway, I entered. And then this person asked me the doubt. And so I clarified it, they left. At that moment I knew that this person will come back and the other person won't come back. Both have heard, but in one there are already a few doubts and he wants to clarify them, whereas in the other there are no doubts because Shravanam itself did not happen. Where is the question of Mananam? Because he just heard to all that, he knew the language he knows and what all the subject matter also he knows, but yet he doesn't know. Shravanam did not happen. Whereas in the other person, some Shravanam happened. That's why he is asking for a doubt. That is Mananam. In spite of doing Shravanam and Mananam, the habits die hard. The habit of dividing. The habit of ego response. Ego response all the time. Somebody says something, ego response. The subject doesn't respond. The truth doesn't respond. The wisdom doesn't respond. It is the ego which responds. This is the habit. The habit is very hard to remove the habit. So, when a question is asked in a manana situation, whether the response should come from wisdom or response should come from ego. That is one way. Then when the question is asked, the question should come from Shravana insight, or insight that is gained by Shravana, or the question comes from ego. Both are problems. Generally, the ego questions and the ego replies. It could be the ego questions and the wisdom replies, or insight replies, or the insight questions and insight replies. That is the ideal situation of learning. That is what is called Guru Shishya. Guru Shishya is not some physical thing. So, it is the knowledge that represents the relationship between Guru and Shishya. Medha. Jushamanana agat. So, in that mantra this point comes, that's why I mentioned it. So it is the knowledge that represents the relationship, not any other thing. Other things could be there or need not be there. That is all incidental or topical. Whereas knowledge represents the relationship between Guru Shishya. Therefore, so the question comes from a kind of insight. Unless some insight is there, how can the question be there? I mean, it should not be ego's question. Ego or person's question. The individual's question. The me's question. The me, mine, man, my story. That individual is there. That individual's question. Or is it the question of the insight? So like that, it is very critical. That's why in Vedanta everything is critical. It is so critical. It is like a laser surgery for the eye, that too. Before you put the switch is put on and off, not for 1 second. If he puts it on and off for 1 second, the eye is gone. There is no eye left. For a microsecond, the switch is put on and off, not physically. A pulse, the pulse will come. The laser itself is released as a pulse. The life of the pulse is 10 to the power of minus 5 seconds. Means 1 millionth of a second or 100,000th part of a second. And then the location where this pulse means a load of energy it is, where it should fall on the eye. Not on the wrong point. Wrong point, if it falls, then the eye is gone. Therefore, the preparation is a very elaborate preparation they make and fix. In fact, I have seen in some radiational treatments, they make a mold for this person. They make the person lie down and put a kind of a liquid substance all around him and fix him in that liquid substance. That liquid substance, it occupies every crevice, it goes in and fixes him. Now you lie down like that for some time. Then this liquid solidifies. You get up. Now you have a mold. You cannot budge 1 micro inch. You are fixed thoroughly. Then they will fix the position of the radiation source. Very critical. Vedanta is like that. In the insight level, it is that critical. And if you miss the point, you will be at it for years without getting anything more than some superficial structure of terminology. So, very critical. Anyway, iti shushruma, we heard. Means that kind of a shravanam mantra, you know. Dhiranam. So, we heard dhira purushas describing the situation of karma and vidya. Who is dhira? Dhiyam rati iti dhira. So dadati. One who gives knowledge. Rati means rai is the dhatu. Rai. So anyway, one who gives the knowledge is dhira. Dhiranam. So, the dhira purushas. Then there is a standard description for dhira, definition of dhira in Gita. So, sama dukkha sukham dhiram somrutatvaya kalpate. That is dhira definition. Gita is its own lexicon. The words of Gita are defined in Gita itself. So, just you wait, you look around and you will get the definition. So, like that you find many, many ways, many times. Yukta, it says. Yukta. Yukta, you don't go to another dictionary. You just look around, you will find there. Yukta ityuchyate tada. Such a person is called yuktaha. So, it gives its own definition. Similarly, dhira. Who is dhira? Sama dukkha sukham dhiram. So, one who is same. The sameness of the mind. That is the dhira. So,
Kalidasa Swamiji describes vikara
hetau. Vikara hetau sati vikriyante yeshanna chetam sita eva dhira. Abhijnana Shakuntala. So, when there is an occasion for the mind getting agitated or disturbed, vikara hetau sati, then the mind doesn't get disturbed and agitated. It remains calm and quiet. The sameness, that is dhira. Even Kalidasa says that. And that is what Krishna says. So dhira means the people who have that sameness. That same, you know what is sameness? Sameness means the absence of ego. That is what sameness means. It is the ego. In a given situation, it is the ego which gets exhilarated or which gets ecstatic, sukha, and it is the ego which becomes sad. You see, you please understand, the arrogance, the ecstasy or ecstatic behavior, the celebratorial behavior, etc. The celebratorial behavior. So all this is ego. And then the sadness, the depression, intense suffering is also same ego. It is the downtrend of ego, that is the uptrend of ego. It is the ego. Some people think that ego means all arrogance and the sadness is not ego. And therefore they want to become sad also. Please note that sadness is ego. It is the negative kind of ego. As much an obstacle to knowledge as the other ego, other kind of ego. Therefore, dukkha is ego, sukha is ego. Samadukkha sukha is egoless. You are not ego now. Sameness is not ego. That is yoga. Samatvam yoga uchyate. Therefore, the resolution of the ego is yoga. Because, I tell you, yoga is communion with the truth, which is in the heart as atma. So it is the ego, the single block or wall that obstructs the truth, is ego. And so that's why when all people ask, who is ignorant? I say there is no who, only ignorance. Don't try to establish the ego any further. Who gets knowledgeable? There is no who, there is only knowledge. This who is the ego, and it is the obstacle. There is no who. Who sees? Nobody sees. There is no who. There is only seeing. Like that. Anyway, so dhiraha means samapurushaha. They are the people of sameness for them. So when such a person speaks, that is the truth. That is called shruti. That is the shruti. Because the ego is not contributing anything to that speech. When ego contributes, that is called. If it is a good ego, I mean a very well-trained and disciplined and elevated ego, it is called smriti, like manusmriti, etc. Or parashara smriti, coming from a very enlightened soul, ego, very high-level ego. But if the low-level ego speaks, it is neither shruti nor smriti, it is all blabber. Therefore, iti shushruma dhiranam. Yenastad vichachakshire. We'll come back. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi Harihi Om Tatsat Shri Krishna Panamastu.